My name's Robert Mahoney. I'm a longtime art critic, and I've had a previous conversation with Dudley Charles. And in that interview, we talked about broad cultural issues related to the fact that he's a Guyanese American artist. And I thought on this one, we would focus more on the micro level of what an artist actually does. In terms of cultural issues today, most critics are being influenced by a more anthropological approach, where we talk about relationships and how people in different cultures behave, and then how that influences how we look at the art, or the role that art plays in that culture. And then, of course, there's the global world. So we dealt with those issues in the previous interview, but this time I thought that if these issues were valid, they would then be reflected in the micro practice of the artist in the studio. And so I'm particularly interested in the fact that while I briefly mentioned it in previous writings on Dudley Charles, this body of work, his Venuses, his Blue Women, the RMH series, the Throop Venus, there's an interesting story about your use of the models in this body of work. So I'd like to address that, and I thought maybe I could figure out a way in which you had a kind of, you established a different relationship with the models than one might conventionally establish, you know, think of when you think of an artist and a model. Usually you think of a artist standing there at the easel, the model's off there, and you were doing something different with your models. So I'd like to address those issues. So let's start with like a painting like RMH, one of those paintings, and tell me exactly the steps involved in how the models contributed to the creation of that work.
In 2004, I was part of an exhibition in Washington, D.C., and the exhibition was called Nude Art Expo. And all the models who were there were basically nude.
They were live nude?
Live nude models, very live.
Right? Okay.
And artists, some of the selective artists, which I was one of them, you know, we were painting. Not literally do a painting of the model, but we were painting this live person doing decoration on the body.
You were actually painting on the body?
Yes, painting on the body, to make this person look, even though they were a live person, we want to make them look something other than what they were or what they are really.
Okay. Right? So what did you do? This is body painting?
Well, partly body painting. We were giving them like a new clothes, like a new presence, right? And then they would walk around, you know, into the crowd of people, or just walk around, you know, exhibiting themselves as part of the artwork. Yeah. So when I was approached, so when in 2011, when I was given this opportunity to do live model the same way, I decided to take the approach as the person is there. Right. All I want is just to make a very quick study of that person. So I put them against the wall or against the paper or this material, and I make this study of them, and I, you know, allow them to walk away.
Uh-huh.
In the same time, while I was making a study, I observe all the, you know, the movements or the texture of the
uh-huh.
person's skin.
Uh-huh.
So they walk. And then I start doing my own interpretation.
So the canvas is here. You had them stand up against
yes,
the canvas.
Yes.
You made some marks.
Yes. Yes. And then they walk.
And then they would walk around, and you'd get some other ideas and
yes,
make some other marks.
Yes. Yes. Correct. Yeah.
And did they walk around the canvas, or
no?
They just walked.
They just
kind of walked around the room.
Yeah, just around the face of the canvas of itself, you know. And when they finish, it only took less than 5 minutes.
And they're nudes at this point? Yeah.
Yeah.
Uh-huh.
Less than five minutes? Yeah, yeah.
No kidding.
And all the rest of the time was up to me to create, you know, something within that.
So that's a short time. So they're what role are they playing? They're not really models in the conventional sense.
No.
You're not doing a portrait of them.
No.
You're not standing off in the distance
doing
a portrait of them.
Yeah.
Do they look at this painting and say, that's me?
Well, I don't want them to look at the work and for them to have the impression and see that that is them.
So it's not a portrait at all?
No, because I look at the work also as what Leonardo da Vinci might have done when he painted his Mona Lisa,
right?
Which there's all the conversation now about Leonardo da Vinci, but this woman, this Mona Lisa, is a real person. But it could have been that.
Which would be the conventional model.
Yeah.
With him at the easel, and that's a real person.
Yes.
But then there's these other ideas.
Yes.
Could have been that, the portrait.
It could have been that he just built up all the ideas of from different women and put it in that one person.
That's right.
Yeah.
Are you more like that?
Well, I mean, that is what I was trying to do. So when I did that, right, and this person removed, it only took me 5 minutes, or maybe less than 5 minutes, but I already know exactly what I want to do.
How? Yeah. You mean something about her?
Yes, something about, I mean, our presence. Okay. Five minutes it took me, yeah.
Because it's just, that throws me for a loop. So you did this with several models?
Yes, I remember. It didn't take very long.
Wait, a long time, or?
No, I don't take very long. I mean, each day, or let's say maybe a day or two after, right, a new model might turn up.
Uh-huh.
And the same process again, bang, finish, yeah. Because once I make that mark, I already know exactly what I wanted.
From her?
Yes.
So each model is a piece of a puzzle?
Yes.
Yeah. All right, great.
I fulfill that feeling, that, you know, that something that I wanted. And I could go, you see, I could go further back with the markings of itself. When I was a child, growing up, I wanted to be involved in sports, right?
Okay.
And I could not, for some reason, I could not be involved. The teacher would not allow me to play sports.
Okay.
So I had to be in the arts and craft.
You went into the arts?
In the arts and craft class. And I hated that so much, with a passion, right? So when they give me the drawing books and the marker, I would mark on it, bang, bang, you know? Like, in a way, saying that, look, I don't want to do this thing, right? I don't want to be an artist. I don't want to be in the art and craft class.
Uh-huh.
Please let me out. So I would make the marks that would literally like scratch the work, scratch this paper so hard and so terrible, as if like I want to tear it, you know? Right? The watercolor, the same thing. I would destroy it, pretending as if I want to mess it up. I want to go and play, right?
Yeah.
But the teacher always, regardless of what, I was never allowed to go outside and play. Right? So I had to stay in there and do that art and craft. The art and craft was on Fridays.
Uh-huh.
And Monday morning, when I got into the class in school, my work was there on display.
Now you're famous for doing what you didn't want to do.
Right. Regardless of what I produced, my work was always up there on the board. I could not have escaped it. And every Monday morning, my parents also, this was my father,
He
made sure that I go to school with a drawing book and some crayons, right? So there was a communication between my teachers and my parents, right? You see, the fact, my mother was a seamstress.
Yeah.
And my father was a carpenter and a joiner, right?
So handiwork.
Yes, so there was a craftsman. And you know, there was this feeling of craftsmanship within the family.
So there's that. That's positive. Then you have the kind of protest element of your drawing.
Yeah. So I could not have escaped it, right?
And did these formative kind of gestures contribute to your eventual vocabulary as an artist?
Because things that happen to you as a child sticks with you all the time, all through the years, right? Oh, true.
That's actually a theme. I'm really into that theme.
Yeah, yes.
Artists, I don't know, they generally talk in formalist terms and they don't bring up that, the genealogy of the...
Right. Even at home, you know, when I got my homework to do, I have to do a drawing. And what I would do at home, I would take some oil, you know, cooking oil, I would try to throw it in the paper in order to destroy it, you know, so that I wouldn't have to carry the homework to school.
Okay, is that, right? Is that the source of your, I guess I'll call it the more expressionistic part of your vocabulary?
Could be, yes. I mean, it started as a
Those
triangle.
Marks show up in the Throop
Venus? Oh, yes. Same thing.
Because I see, like, on that, I think RMH, you have, like, it looks like almost a rubbing.
Yeah.
A rubbing?
Oh, yeah. Yeah. I used to do that. I would rub the paper, right?
Is this, do you think it comes from that earlier?
Of course.
Okay. But it's different. So,
Yeah, because, you know, you go through all the years and years of being an artist, over 40 years, I mean, it tends to realize that, okay, right. This is going to stick with you for life. And as a matter of fact, my parents now, I mean, they would go about, oh, I have this son, he's an artist.
All right, so we're talking about your vocabulary of mark making that you have, which is pretty extensive.
Yeah.
And that's one of the exciting elements of the work and one of the mysteries of it. So that's what I'm trying to uncover.
Yeah.
So you've talked about this kind of protest element.
Yeah.
Because you didn't want to be in the arts. But then you also have the positive family handicraft element, so it's got to be kind of a physical thing.
Yes.
And now there was another category of marks that you had developed. What were you talking about there?
Yeah, we were talking about, I would use all sort of things to destroy my works.
That's right.
Yeah. I would throw oil on the paper. I literally wanted to destroy this paper so much, right? That I would not could put any mark on it, not be able to draw on it.
Because being an artist wasn't cool.
No. You want to play
sports. You want to be an athlete. You want to be soccer, right?
Yes, I want to play football. Yeah, I want to play cricket. I want to go out and play cricket.
That's right.
Cricket. Yes. I want to go and play sports. You know?
Right. So that's a really key element.
Because being in the art and craft class was seen as a girl's sport.
Yeah,
well,
we all went through that, right?
Yeah,
the 70s, the 60s, whatever.
Yeah, it was seen as a girl's sport, you know. So I couldn't understand that. But as a child, you had to do what the teacher says,
right,
or what your parents says.
Right.
Because if you didn't do it, when you get home, you're going to get it from the teacher first.
And if you're excelling in the arts, that becomes like your ticket to moving forward. I mean, what are you going to do? That's your destiny then.
But, I mean, I didn't mind.
All those mark makings were protest mark makings.
Yes.
And then we got into the rubbing element. So the rubbing element comes from where?
Also the same rubbing, because I would rub the canvas in the sense that, no, I would rub the paper.
Uh-huh.
Right? I would just rub the paper just in order to destroy it.
Uh-huh.
Because I found out that when I make these marks, they enjoy the marking.
Yeah.
Right? So let me destroy the paper now. They love it also too.
Oh.
They think that I'm a great artist.
So you're trying to destroy it.
Yeah.
And they just love it even more.
They think that I'm a great artist.
You're totally caught.
Right. I could not got away from
that. That's pretty true.
And then, having all these, a bundle or a group of art, I call them.
Uh-huh.
Masterpieces.
Yes.
You know, my father decided to take them to show his, not really his workmate, or people in the, where that he was working with, because he was being employed at the sugar plantation as one of the carpentry work and joinery, and was making furniture for the estate manager.
Yes.
So he decided to take my masterpiece, you know, pieces. No, and showed it around, right? And there, one woman, I know her, I never forgot her name actually. Her name was Mrs. Gloria Dornelis. She says, oh, well, I'm just saying, I think what she says, oh, you have a great son, he's a good artist, he's a great artist. I must recommend him to see someone, you know. And she wrote the name down. She says, okay, right.
So you were stuck.
Took him, I'm going to write an invitation or a letter to someone who I know. His name is Donald Locke. He's an art teacher at Queen's
Donald
College.
Locke. And then that's your, right. He's an art, your teacher.
Yeah, he's an art teacher at Queen's College. And she gave me this note, you know, and I went to Donald, along with a masterpiece at one of his art class, right? And he looked at them, you know, after he looked at me, he says, talent is not enough, you know. You must have this, well, in Guyana, you must think, you must have this guts, you know, the guts to, you know, to proceed, to do the things, you know. And then you decided to show me the language, the pictorial language, how to express myself more into the arts, you know.
And particularly with the rubbing, because yeah. Now you've told me that it was a negative, one of the negative gestures.
Yeah.
But the last time we talked, you talked about how when you, particularly with the blues, and the Blue Venus, that you just can rub it for, you said like hours, really.
Yes, because
it's turned into something else.
Yeah. Yeah, you know, you should.
So talk about that, how yes. the negative thing turns into, that's yeah. Yeah. art school and that's getting older and more experience and all that stuff,
yes.
right?
But it first started out to being as like a revolt against this thing. I did not.
That's right.
You know? But after Donald, he showed me the language, what I could get from it, you know, by doing this and doing that, I began to like it more. And I began to feel more confident, you know, I began to feel more at ease. Yeah, man. I'm an artist now, you know. Yes, I can do these things.
Right, so it turned from a gesture of protest into one of your fortes.
Yes.
The rubbing's always been part of your work?
Yeah.
Part of your vocabulary?
Yeah, yeah. Oh, yeah, of course, yeah.
So Donald Locke was the one who oversaw that
transformation,
you know, from a protest into a...
Yeah, yes. You know, he guided me into this, you know.
Part of your vocabulary.
He led me into this path, you know. And he showed me what I could do, what I could become, you know, how I could experiment with works, how I could experiment with materials and such to make things happen, to give them my vision, you know, to make things work for me.
All right, so that's really good because that I was wondering, you know, where is genealogy? That's what Foucault said.
Yeah.
Foucault has a genealogy. But what about the fact that you outline the model when she's standing up there? So that's another series of marks, almost like a silhouette.
Yeah.
Where did that come from?
Oh, so we go back to Donald.
Back to Donald, right?
Because what he would make me do, right, in his art class, he would pick a leaf. He would say, go and pick a leaf from anywhere,
uh-huh.
right? And I would look at the leaf. He said, look at the leaf for a couple of minutes. He said, look at the leaf for how long you want to look at it, right? And as I look at the leaf, he said, put the leaf down now. And there's the paper. I want you to draw what you just see.
Uh-huh.
Right?
Yeah.
Now, I have to make a mental note, right? To me, it was like a dictation, you know, a pictorial dictation. Right, I see what I just see, and then I gotta make the mark of it on the paper. So these models, they're there. I make a mark. I already make exactly, I know exactly what I have and what I want to do from there on. So you see, come back to the leaf. Yes.
Right. Did you know before you see the model or after you see the model?
Oh.
I mean, I just wanna get a sense of to what degree does the particular model play almost as a collaborator, or is she just a catalyst for the mark making?
Yeah, she's there.
Right.
She's there, right? If she wasn't there, I would not be able to create that work.
Why?
No, because
the energy level?
No. She's not there. She's not there, you know, the presence, you know, right? I would not be able to make that, like the leaf, I see it. And I remember the shapes and the form,
uh-huh.
everything about it. I throw it aside, then I got to retrace
so it
back.
So it's got to take place 1, 2, 3.
Yes.
In present time.
Yes. Yes.
So she's like the leaf.
Yes.
Great, I got
it. I did right away.
Very good.
Right.
And one model after another would come in and
some
of them you're doing what looks like drawings of them.
Yes, yes, yes.
The Throop Venus.
Yeah, you know, like I allow myself that liberty, you know, to say, oh man, you know, I could do this too, right?
Yes.
And I go ahead and do it, you know.
At no time did you try the Eve Klein gesture, you know what I'm referring to, using the model's body as like a paintbrush?
Yeah,
you
know, I know.
You don't do that?
No, I don't do that.
I didn't think I saw any of that.
No, I want to be... Like I'm in control. I don't want anybody else to do the painting for me. I don't want anybody else to do this work for me. You know, I want to make a start, and I want to finish it. I mean, I want to play this game all by myself, you know.
That's right.
Yeah.
Okay. So that's another curveball you've thrown. I actually thought that what I was seeing was not the traditional artist in control model over there. And the story of modern art is that before modern art, the sitter was in control. So the painting had to look exactly like the sitter and compliment the sitter. So this one approach I followed calls that the prototype.
Yeah.
That was in control. The artist was secondary to that. And the story of modern art is that you want a Picasso portrait, you take what Picasso gives you.
Yeah.
You know, you don't say, this is not what I want.
No.
So the artist became in control. Yeah. So they're catalysts, they're instruments.
Yeah.
When they came in, when you called them off the street,
from
the neighborhood, right? So when they came in, were they saying, I'm getting a portrait of myself? Did that what they think?
No. I just said, you know, I just want to do a portrait of, but in a sense that I just want to, you know, to paint something you. I just want to make a drawing of you, a sketch of you. I said sketch.
Okay.
Right?
But see, that means that in their mind, they think they're going to get a sketch of you, of them.
Yeah.
And what did they say when they saw a few little...
Yeah.
Well, some of them are sketches.
Yeah.
They're nice.
I'm not going to do anything that anybody would recognize that this is you, right? That you are this person.
So they knew that.
Yeah, so if it's 25 years from now, 100 years, nobody must know that this is that person, you know? They must never associate it with that. You, the model, will know, right?
Most of them got it.
They got it.
They were being asked to basically contribute a vibe to the creation of a work of art.
Yeah, yeah.
And how long did this go on? This was a week or two?
Well, I think about 3 months.
Okay.
Yeah, I think 3 months okay. We did this. Yeah.
And this became like a regular way of working.
Oh, yeah.
And you worked this way before?
No.
You haven't? Why now?
Why this?
In this body of work?
Yeah. Artists, I mean, we liked new things. We like to experiment with new things, right? You know, and I see myself, okay, like this space. This is my studio. Now, I'm working on me all the time. I'm experimenting on me all the time.
Okay.
It's like, I'm the scientist.
Okay.
Right?
Okay.
This is my studio. Now, what do I want to experiment with? Who? What? How? Right? You know, in a way, like, I always wanted to be, not really in charge, but I always looking for something new. And there's, you know, there's always a newness to everything. There's always a newness.
But you've done figures before.
Oh yeah, yes.
But how are they different?
Yeah.
You would draw them in the more traditional way?
Yeah, I mean, you know, you look at them and you draw them, right? But to me, as I've said before, there's something that you have to go back to. I mean, you do that, yeah. Right? You're allowed to do that because when in the art class, they want you to do, you have to do this figure the way they want you to do it, right? I mean, Donald gave me that also too, right? But what he gave me was the modern vision that I could look at things. Mm-hmm. Because, you know, we discuss the human body also too, because he told me when he was in art class, right, that he had to draw exactly what the professor or the teacher tells them to do.
The life class tradition.
Yes, life drawing. Life worth. Yeah, you have to do that, right?
They still do it.
Yeah.
There was one model that you actually had, it looked like you moved her a few times across the surface of the drawing, right?
Yeah. What did she do?
She moved?
Yeah, she moved.
We're talking about RMH1.
Yeah.
And in that one, you took the model and you kind of rolled her, what, two turns across the canvas?
I think about three times.
She rolled herself.
You know, she moved herself. She moved, right?
So she's moving her naked body across canvas.
Yes, and I'm making a mark.
And
as
you're
she
making
moved.
Marks
as she moved.
Against her body and the canvas, right there.
Yes, yeah, so I drew the line, and as she moved, I drew another line.
She was okay with that?
Yeah. Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Oh, so yeah. She's very sophisticated.
Oh yeah. Right? Yeah. She loved it.
She did.
Yeah.
She loved it. Mm-hmm. Interesting.
I enjoy that, you know. She loved it. I mean, she was just, it was a freedom for her, you know.
And why the thing? There's a movement. So
yes.
The mark making is also about leaving marks of movement.
Yes.
That's involved in that too. So there was dancing, there's movement about the room.
Yes.
They're up against the canvas.
Yeah.
All in 5 minutes. And then they put their clothes on and went.
Yeah, yes. It didn't take that.
Where did you get this idea of doing this? If you hadn't done this before with models.
Yeah.
It obviously worked because you created a really great series of large scale drawings. Where did the idea come from?
You see, I realized one thing, that I was given an opportunity to be in a space. Now, I do not know at the time how long it could have been, a day, 2 days, uh-huh. 3 days, right? So I just want to make you, I know that I had to do something.
Okay.
I had to make use of the time.
Okay.
Right? So that, you know, it was like a sort of urgency.
So you're here and you feel you got to do something. It's urgent.
Yeah, yeah.
And your idea was to bring the models in and do this kind of
Very, 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 very efficient and quick pace, you know. So when they leave, you know, I got to continue, okay, right.
But, I was talking about, so the voice aspect of things. I'm still trying to get at what these models were. I didn't get the answer to where you got this idea. Was it a New York idea? Was it just something you've always been wanting to do and never did?
It never occurred to me, and I didn't think about it in any way.
All right.
So when I come to New York, there's a different kind of energy.
Absolutely.
In New York.
It's like constant.
It's a different kind of energy. You know, it's like, it is 24/7.
So we're in New York, and this is not, I'm not saying a sexist thing, but one of the aspects of the energy of New York is the fact that you're walking around seeing all these people.
And
if you're a man, you're seeing a lot of women.
Yeah.
That's part of the energy of the city, is the all the people moving around. So you're in your studio.
Yeah.
And
my studio was
right down the street.
Yes, right to the street, actually. If I stretch my hand for very long out, I could probably touch the women. Yeah.
So they were that close?
Yeah, they were close.
And they were hanging out there?
Hanging out there. You know,
and you heard them?
I mean, the window was open, the shutter was open most of the time, right?
Uh-huh.
Because I'm there very, very extremely late.
Again, in the traditional artist-model relationship, the artist is in total control, the modern artist. And the model is just there, and whatever the artist comes up to, the model just has to go, okay, that's Picasso, what am I going to do? That's Picasso. And that model of the power relationships between the artist and reality was established about 1860 in the West.
Yeah.
And it's been going on for now about 130 years. And I'm beginning to sense a certain shift toward the viewer. I've noticed a lot of artists taking a more passive stance, a more open stance toward their material. They don't want to be the imperial artist, the Picasso figure. Look at that, that's a Picasso. So I think I've got this is where we ended up with our interview. You're a little bit between Guyana and the world, a little bit between the yellow tree and the Lexus, and you're a little bit between the modern concept of the artist in control. You want to be in control of your painting. And you made it clear that you're in control and the models are instruments of that.
Yeah.
But at the same time, there's this it's not imperial. It's not you're not being an expressionistic who's like dominating the model. You're certainly not turning them into objects. The Western tradition is, you know, the Yves Klein thing we mentioned. That was his extension of Jackson Pollock's ideas toward using the artist-model relationship in that sense. But he was using those models as paintbrushes. They were objects. I don't get that sense of object at all in your work.
No.
That's probably the link between your studio practice and the larger cultural framework that we talked about previously that we're not getting into here, but that's probably the link. There's a different relationship there between you and your models than I see in Eve Klein, you know, the drawing and the using the body or that kind of thing.
You know, I definitely do not want to have a relationship with them. I see this man as these folks out in the streets. I mean, they see me tomorrow, they probably recognize me.
Uh-huh.
But I won't recognize them, you know?
That's right. They're just part of the passing.
And if
tomorrow... It's a little sad. That's the reality, right?
Yeah. And if tomorrow, you know, I'm giving a studio space again and people come again,
uh-huh.
the same freshness, you know? I would feel that same freshness.
Will you do this again, or was this just the right thing? Now this worked.
Yes.
This created some really wonderful works of art.
Yeah.
So you'll try it again.
Yeah, of course.
You know, so you've added it to your vocabulary.
Oh, yeah. I'm
that you've been building up since the little protest. And you found another one, and that's how it worked. That's how you keep alive as an artist.
And coming to New York, it has given me that opportunity to express myself. In such a way, you know, in such a way that I feel, okay, this is a privilege, this is, I have to make use of this.
That's right.
You know?
The pressure of being in the big city.
Yeah, you know, you can't.
The center of the art world, you have to do something.
Yeah, you know, you can't come to New York, more or less, you can't come to Brooklyn.
Yeah.
And not behave bad, you know
That's
what
right.
I mean?
That's
you know?
Right.
You know, I consider myself a Brooklynite, you know?